Well, the good news and the bad news, both are very intense right now. The bad news is very bad. The good news is very good. So we simply abide in the mood of repentance here and consider the situation with great clarity here, which we will. The good news first. The good news first, of course. Good news first. As I've said several nights ago, I had a meeting in spirit while I was half asleep with Jesus. Now, what I want to convey here is there were people moving around all over the place, and Jesus was just sitting on the ground, and nobody was going up to him. And I saw him there, and I said, oh, I'm going to go up to him and say hello. Nobody else did. Nobody else did. Why? 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 Because everybody thinks that Jesus is this incredible, powerful personage, you know, this awesome being and everything, and these Lord of Lords and sitting on the golden throne, and they're completely intimidated and in awe of that. But see, that's not the Jesus I know at all. So I spent my lifetime listening to his words. So his words are very, his ideas are very familiar to me. I know what his ideas are. So I am perfectly comfortable with that. Now, what I found Jesus to be is the most humble, unassuming being you can imagine. This comes from this feeling of absolute safety, that he knows he cannot lose anything. Loss is impossible. So there's no insecurity in him whatsoever. Not a shred of insecurity. Therefore, he doesn't have to prove himself in any way. You don't get the feeling like he needs to prove himself to anyone. There's no needs at all. He has no needs. So he's calm. He's relaxed. He's peaceful. He's unassuming. He's quiet. He doesn't feel he needs to prove anything to anyone. He knows he doesn't need to. Nobody does. But he's peaceful, calm, serene, friendly, humorous. But just, you know, if you saw him, you'd just say, oh, it's nobody, you know. It's nobody important. But if people think, oh, it's Jesus, they're going to freak out. They say, oh my God, you know, he's some high, mighty. No, he knows he's not above you. He's not below you. There is no above or below. Equal, equal, equal. Same, same, equal, equal. He talks to you as an equal, exactly as an equal. Like you're his best friend. You're his best friend. Like he's always known you. You've always known him, and he's talking like the dearest friend, and relaxed and calm, and not throwing a bunch of esoteric stuff at you, or like I'm a great master, or nothing like that. Nothing like that. So, yeah, it must be difficult for him because nobody wants to come up and say, sit down and visit with him. I won't say nobody, but it's not common, I would say, because the people, he would say, that's Jesus. Oh my God. This is some, you know, vast, incredible, mighty, powerful, intense, dominating, too much for me. It's not like that at all. It's the opposite. Completely humble. Completely unassuming, humble. Not bragging, not boasting in the slightest bit about anything. No need to impress you. Not trying to impress you in the slightest bit. You don't need to impress him in the slightest bit. He's talking to an equal there. An equal. All are one. We are the one sonship. All are the one sonship. There's no higher and lower in the sonship. And he knows this. He knows this for a fact. So, anyway, good news. He invited me to his house. And I was kind of surprised. I hadn't expected that at all. So I said, wow, yeah. Sure, I'll come to your house. That's great. Get an invitation from Jesus to visit his house? Are you kidding? I said, yeah, absolutely. Let's go. So, I woke up from the dream there, but it, in my mind's eye, I've been trying to see in my mind's eye, what does this house look like? So in my mind's eye, I took like a view of it. And what I saw was, again, this completely unassuming, modest front to the house. Just a little sidewalk, just going along the neighborhood. Just a single, you know, little concrete walkway right up to the one-step porch. Simple door. Like white stucco, just a sort of white stone house. So everything was white. Very small, the front area was very small. No ornamentation, nothing. It was the most unassuming, modest front of a house you could imagine. You just say, there's nobody's here of any importance in the slightest bit. And then on each side of this front, there was the shrubbery that went for quite some ways on each side of the doorway. And there might have been a couple of, I didn't even notice that there's any windows actually to look in. I didn't see any windows. So you look at that and you just say, there's nothing there. There's nothing there, nobody important, nothing. Okay. But I said, hey, I wonder what it's like inside. See, that's the question. What's it like inside? From the superficiality appearances, doesn't attract the slightest bit of attention. There's nothing there on the front. No tile work, nothing ornate. It's just like plaster. I think it's like plaster. White plaster wall. Door on each side, white plaster wall, and it goes off on the side. This cover with this dense shrubbery on either side. Okay. So then I said, you know what? I should go inside. In my mind's eye, I was taking a in my imagination, as it were, spiritually, I was saying, let's see what's inside. So I went inside. And that's when I said, oh. Wow. What I saw was an open courtyard. And the front, where you go inside, there are wings on either side, like a courtyard. It's like a three-sided courtyard. Okay, and the four side, directly looking from the doorway, the four sides open. Okay, but on three sides, there's this courtyard. And there's the building goes around this courtyard. And the building is like these open as far as like arches with arches instead of walls. The courtyard is not walled off. The building's not walled off from the courtyard. There's these areas of shade that are roofed off, like a pavilion, sort of a three-sided pavilion with some poles, arches actually coming down to support the roof of the pavilion. And just all these places just to sit. And what you do is you just sit and you're looking at this courtyard. Everyone just is there, just hanging out. That's it. I didn't know he was talking or visiting or socializing. And I just noticed that maybe there's some few people here and there. But what I was paying attention to was the courtyard. And I started spending a lot of time getting a sense like, wow, what is this? What is this? What is this? It seems like there was this a pool, beautiful pool, water, architecture, so to speak, and like sort of a fountain area in the middle, and what I gradually began to realize is, well, this fountain and the water, a lot of water features and water, beautiful water and light, and the courtyard, this whole courtyard area was like putting on this incredibly beautiful display. Just gorgeous, shimmering water, and just the beauty was just off the charts. And everyone was just sitting there watching this. And there seemed to be like beautiful, beautiful stonework, colored, reflecting light, the water, the way the reflections, created this just multi-dimensional, beautiful, constantly changing display. That was just awesome beauty. Now, I spent some more time looking at this and seeing how beautiful it was. And then I started to think, hey, you know what? I get the sense that the people sitting in the courtyard are actually creating this display through their spiritual will, their spiritual creativity. I said, wow, that's pretty cool. Because it's so creative, the way everything just kept manifesting and changing and subsiding into the just shimmering, peaceful calm of pools. There's all these sort of pools and the way it was laid out, even that seemed to be changing too. Everything was kind of fluid, so to speak. And I believe that everybody was contributing together their thoughts, their creative will was together being harmonized by the light, by this living light, which was presenting itself in forms of light, tone, color, liquid, you see, and some semi-solidness, so to speak. Anything and everything would be displayed there, manifested there, but somehow all the different will of everyone, what they wanted to see, was somehow being manifested and harmonized. I was watching this and I was just like, it was, you know, off the charts beautiful. There's nothing in this world that can remotely compare. Everything is fresh, everything is clean, there's no sign of decay or death anywhere. It's effortless, it's free. There's no way we can duplicate this in this world, even remotely. It would be a farce to duplicate it. It's even to try, although obviously we have tried, you know, the Mughals' gardens and fountains is beautiful and stuff like that. It's like a snapshot, try to get it, but it completely fails to get the flowing, seamless flowing livingness of what's going on. It never stops. It's always reflecting our desires of what we want to see in a beautiful way. It's always responsive. But it's in this sort of structure like a courtyard, and you just sit there poolside in a chair and just experience it. Now, what I realized is, hey, you can participate with your creativity. You know, what do you want to see? And add to it. And that's what everybody's there for. It's a collectively, everyone there is just giving their creativity to it and then seeing it reflected back to everyone else. Everyone's seeing that reflection there. Now how the light harmonizes it all and you get to see, and it's better than you can even imagine actually. Because you give your little imagination to it, as it were, a creative imagination to it. And everyone else is giving theirs and the light harmonizes. What you're actually seeing is way more beautiful than what your own particular desire was, so to speak. And yet somehow that's there too. That's there too. So there's both individuality and collectivity, but the collectivity, the beauty of it, it doesn't represent any one particular viewpoint or desire, but it somehow represents the all of it. And the sum, the total is greater than the sum of the parts. So, you know, it's like, it's better. It's always better than you're expecting. And this is Jesus' home. Welcome to Jesus' home. I said, wow. And the air, you know, the air, the light is also alive and sparkling and beautiful. The whole atmosphere, the courtyard, the pooling, the stonework, the tile work, whatever's there, then the water, the atmosphere, it's all living, it's all participating in this incredible, beautiful display. And then out beyond the pool, I sort of seem to say, okay, out there, you seem to see like beautiful orchards and greenery and grass and beautiful soft rolling hills, so to speak, and then it goes off in the distance. in the distance you see might see like an ocean or a beautiful ocean in the distance, and bigger trees off in the distance, and cloud formations over the ocean, beautiful cloud formations. All of that, the whole thing, you're experiencing live. It's all live. It's all changing in response to what you want to see, what you want to experience. Now, if you're familiar with the teachings of the astral realm, which Sri Yukteswar and gave to Paramahansa Yogananda in the book Autobiography of a Yogi, that he explained that he was in the causal realm, I think. He was teaching in the high causal realm, I believe. He explained that the astral realm, the causal realm, how beautiful it is, how light is totally responsive to what you want to see. So this was an expression on the astral realm, I would say, a fairly beautiful level of the astral realm, maybe the fifth level of the astral realm, something like that. And it was an experience of collective collective creativity, which I've never experienced before. Here we actually get that in like symphonies and stuff, which I have been part of that whole symphonic scene in a previous life, and collectively getting together producing music. But this is the real deal. That other stuff here, we're trying to limit creativity to definition and interpretation and experience and image and form, whereas there it's you get the feeling of formlessness, infinite plasticity, instantaneous, spontaneous, intelligent, living light, okay, without a need of any definition, without a need of any interpretation. It is continually seamlessly reflecting to you the beauty that you want to see and more. And you get used to this, and what happens, you get more and more used to this and doing this, and then you go on to even higher realms, higher realms and higher realms, and causal realm, and then from the causal realm you eventually go even beyond that into the pure essence of the absolute, where the whole, you're aware of the entire, all of creation, and you're participating as all in all of all creation, and the beauty is, you know, beyond anything we can remotely comprehend where we're at now. So this just represented the next step. So as I said, there are several steps that have to be taken before we get back to functioning as we were truly created to function. And the path is gradualism. So this is just the next step. I understand that, but qualitatively, it is just so much better than anything you're ever going to get in this world. Now the tech people are trying to reverse engineer this and put it into form, and with all their digital, you know, technology, and they're trying to hook our brains up to computers, and so we can all engage in virtual reality together. And they're trying to find some way. The Luciferians are trying to find some way to say here, hey, don't worry, you don't need to go to Jesus's house. You could just stay in this world of form here, and you can be happy here. And I have to say, after, in my mind's eye, experiencing this, you can't, it's apples and oranges. It's kind of like inscribing a symbol on a stone, for instance, and scratching some symbol, and say, this symbolizes the universe. Okay, and all you gotta do is look at this symbol, and you'll be happy. And instead of looking at the whole flow of the universe, you know, because you made a symbol, it's kind of like that. You can make a symbol of anything. Say, well, this stands for, you know, this experiencing. Here's an experience to look at. This is, you know, this stands for, this symbolizes it. That's like saying that you're thirsty and you scratch something in the dirt. So this is H2O. Oh. Is that supposed to make you quench your thirst? It doesn't quench your thirst. So we have a thirst for this type of experiencing that the tech people cannot give to us. It cannot give to us. It's not the same at all. It is not the same. First thing, we were in everything around. The whole structure was built of living light, and it was alive. And you could tell it wasn't frozen, it wasn't dead light, and you could feel, and the beauty, the subtle beauty of all the structure was constantly flowing and moving, and just like, wow, the whole place was just living, alive. Okay, no bills, no needs. You didn't feel hungry or sick or anything like that. You felt perfectly safe. No need to defend yourself. No abyss. Every aspect of this world here, wasn't there like that at all. So, you know, if you're in this world hooking yourself up to some high-def television and trying to get it, consider where you are. Consider the entire experience. It's nothing like it. It's nothing like it. It is just you're settling for absolute crumbs. And those crumbs cannot really solve the continuity problem for you. Now, the people in this world are screaming, I just give me a crumb, please. I'm so desperate, you know. But so it's easy to get sucked into the world and trying to supply people. You know the old parable about somebody says you give someone a fish, you feed him for a day. Teach him how to fish, you feed him for a lifetime. What people here, they're so lazy, they're so afraid. The continuity fear causes such problems for them. They feel, oh, I can't learn how to fish. I'll never be able to learn how to fish. Because to them, that's the abyss, actually. It's the abyss. And so they say, give me a fish, give me a fish, give me. And you feel so sorry for him. I feel so sorry for them. I said, I'll try to do something really beautiful for you. At least give you just some faint, faint idea of it. Oh, I say, thank you, thank you, thank you. And really they say, look, we'll worship you as God. If you just give us a crumb, just give us a crumb. Just feed us with something that makes us, give us some relief here, you know. So I tried to figure out something to do to help people. I felt so sorry for them because they insisted that they can never do this. Well, the fact is, within you, your mind's eye can even imagine this. I just sat down this morning, I think. I just imagined it. Just imagine going to Jesus' courtyard, house, and he says, courtyard. Oh, my gosh. Yeah. And there's no question that some of the great Mughals and throughout history, we've tried to give some sense of that, you know, with these beautiful courtyards with fountains and everything like that, and how the astral realm can be and how beautiful it is. They try to remind themselves or at least give some sense of it, but it's a pale, pale shadow, you know, at best. It's even misleading. It doesn't really give you what you need at all. So what we need here is to work on the continuity fear. But anyway, what I did was I tried to find some creative way to help people out. I work with video feedback. I actually invented a way to videotape video feedback. I had a number of monitors, old monitors, that would give the right feedback, and several cameras. And I was able to capture some incredibly beautiful liquid light displays on using video feedback. It was quite incredible. I made videos of those and I put them on VHS, and nobody was interested, and I threw them all away. I don't have any record of all that creative work I did, but it was some of the most beautiful, maybe the most beautiful displays I've ever seen in this world. It was that beautiful, but it was still nothing compared to what you can see. Nothing like it. Pale, pale, pale shadow. Now, I've also tried to compose beautiful music, thinking that'll at least give people some sense of the beauty, you know, the harmony. You know, could we just give this beautiful singing harmonies? Again, the faintest of pale shadows that is very misleading if you think that that's it. And then also the work with detergent and colored sugar in the videos I've made of corn syrup, detergent, water, all this stuff. That's like very flowing and very liquid and very beautiful and very formless. And that, you know, that's still doesn't give even the faintest, because the faintest, faintest pale shadow of what you're actually experiencing. The quality simply isn't there. Nothing is really there. But certainly, you want to stress that there are no body forms in what you're seeing at all. Never is there a body form ever appears. So it's very important to keep bodies out of artwork. If you're going to even give the faintest of shadows, you need to keep the human body out of whatever artwork you're doing. Make it abstract, make it flowing, but I don't suggest doing that at all, actually. I wasted a lot of time on that. because that doesn't really help. It doesn't really help. Because the continuity fear is what keeps us from experiencing. And just giving someone this flat, looking something on a screen like this, it doesn't give us the right impression of what's there for us. And it doesn't really cure the continuity fear. It might help a little bit, I don't know exactly how to measure this out. The detergent work that I did was wow. I mean, it's pretty amazing. And just doing it, that was way more amazing than someone watching it on the screen, actually. It was quite stunning in beauty. So maybe it helped me a little bit. It's possible. Maybe super high culture and art can help a little bit. But that has to be like a 10% or 5% of what you do, or 1%. The rest has to be affirmations, declarations, clarifications. Okay, clarifications, affirmations, declarations, silence. Practice the silent sitting. Practice the silent sitting. Because when you're there watching this, you're not moving around, you're not socializing, you're not dancing, you're not doing any of that stuff. You're sitting there and really forgetting all about the body. Forgetting all about the body. Because your attention is on this scintillating, shimmering. But there's just no limit to what you can see there, what you can experience there. But that's just a beginning. But it's a great beginning. Actually, it's a great beginning. So this is Jesus' house on the lower levels of light, you see, like that. And the mistake people make is to try to get some sense of that here and say, okay, I'm satisfied with that. This is my home form, body, that's what I am. So I need to get some sense of happiness. That's the mistake. You have to evaporate the continuity fear so you can actually experience this for yourself. Experience it for yourself. As Sri Nisargadatta always would say, when they'd keep pestering him, what's it like? What's it like? He says, come on in. Come on in and experience it for yourself. You have to. You'll never get a true sense of it unless you actually experience it for yourself. And you have to experience it for yourself, because that really starts evaporating your continuity fear to a much higher degree, actually. And you begin to realize that you can function as this totality, and it's better than this trying to function as an isolated, alone person. Now, people get into choirs, they sing in the church choir, they play piano, that's fine. But again, that's not bad. At least you're contributing your voice with others, blending and realizing that the sound, the overall sound of a choir is better than just one voice alone, as it were. And a combination is can be tremendous. So that's a little taste, little taste. But very pale again. And the declarations, clarifications, declarations, affirmations. CDA, the CDA. Clarifications, affirmations, declarations, and silence, 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 silence. The ability to sit still and just silently. That's what gets you ready. That's what prepares you. That's what prepares you for this. That's why I could sit down with Jesus and just talk. Familiar with his ideas, he knew I was, it's no problem. And then he just said, hey, come on over to my house. In other words, he's saying, I think you might like this. I said, okay. Now, we're afraid if we contribute our creativity, like I'm a newcomer, we'll wreck the rest of it, because everybody else there has probably been there a long time and they're really good at it. And maybe my thoughts are, not so creative, not so nice, not so beautiful, whatever. Not my thoughts, my creativity. But here's the thing. The light harmonizes everything. to make it all, again, better than anything. So everyone contributing, it doesn't matter what you're contributing, the light itself reflects back to us. You know, it's just, you can't lose. You cannot lose with that, with this display. And at times it's very faceted and crystalline. It's like liquid crystalline facetedness, but it can be anything else too. I mean, there's just depth to it and the reflection of it. You know, it's like more the, you know, diamonds give us the faint pale shadow. The most beautiful diamond necklaces and jewelry, you know, the faintest pale shadow of it, really. It's almost like a farcical spitting on it, almost. Like, oh, look at these diamonds, how beautiful they are. It's like, are you kidding me? Who are you trying to kid? That kind of thing. Oh, look at this body with all these beautiful diamonds. Don't you want to just worship me? And you know, that's a joke. It's a bad joke, actually. It's a bad joke compared to this Jesus' courtyard. My God. It's like living diamonds. Is that just manifest. You see, now keep in mind that everything that is unmanifest is free to manifest it at any moment. Everything. And everything that is manifest is free to unmanifest at any moment. So the light just calls whatever you want to see and then harmonizes it out of the unmanifest just effortlessly. It just arises there. It just arises. And then it flows back into the unmanifest. You see, there's this beautiful flowing taking place seamlessly. And so you can have this massive, beautiful, geometric shape of flowingness that is just like all diamondness. And you can see right through it, as it were, and there's all these facets, and each facet can be reflecting, you know, an endless landscape of beauty. And it's all harmonized, and nothing is conflicting. And then this just kind of melt down slowly and beautiful. You know, golden scintillation can arise around like a mist, and it just goes on and on and on and on. It's just like, this is like more beautiful than anything I've ever imagined. Yeah, and it's right there, just simple, right there in the courtyard. Welcome to the high astral realm. Everything is beautiful. Whatever you're imagining, the light, it's fresh, it's clean, it's pure, it's radiant, it's so, you know, just the light is so beautiful. Whatever. Wow. And the sounds are so subtle, but they just kind of permeate you. I wasn't really aware of any music, so to speak, but There could have been. I wasn't focusing on that. I was focusing on the visual. So our attempts to copy this, reverse engineer it and copy it, are a sick joke, actually. A really sick joke. It's a very bad sick joke. Who are we kidding? Why? If we can experience this, why do we try to represent it in the crude fashion? Why? Because we're trying to say we're greater than God. That these definitions are prior to it. So we're the ones creating the whole situation. You know, it's just ridiculous. It's like telling somebody on dry land what it's like to swim, to be immersed in water, and just swimming and feeling the water. And they say, oh, okay, I get it. Yeah, water, okay, he said this. I don't even know what water is, but okay. Yeah, I understand. I've defined it now. Yeah, it's just ludicrous. So the only problem we have is the continuity problem. It keeps us from this. We're afraid. We're afraid of this. And the fear is ideological. I don't believe you can, like I said, try to represent this with really cool graphics here, which I've done a ton of. After Effects, Photoshop, Premiere, video feedback. I just did everything, special effects. And still this detergent was even more sophisticated, actually. Micro photography, what they call it, and close up. And seeing so much beautiful photography and everything, it's all dead. It's like looking at a corpse compared to looking at something living, okay? Maybe that's a good example. Everything in this world is like a corpse. It's like a corpse. And this experiencing in Jesus' courtyard is like something that is vibrantly alive, okay? So are you really going to get the experience of vibrant aliveness from worshiping a corpse? That's the question. And in the course, it's a statement too. Obviously not. So you have to stop worshiping the corpse. You have to say, I don't need the corpse. Nobody needs the corpse. This was all a ridiculous attempt to turn our back on God. There's no necessity to this realm at all. We don't need this world. And I don't have to solve any of the problems of this corpse. The problem is, it doesn't remotely satisfy me. And I don't have to solve that problem by dressing the corpse up. I can solve the problem by turning my back on the corpse and paying attention to life. That's how you solve the problem. The corpse is only there because we wanted to turn our back on God. And this gives us an excuse. We say, oh, no, I wasn't turning my back on you, God. I was just looking at this wonderful corpse that was here. It's way better than reality. That's why I turned away. No. When we decided that we're going to turn our back on God just for the fun of it, we then imagined an excuse, a reason for it. See, it wasn't like we said, oh, I just want to do it, God, because to see what happens. We said, no. There's this other realm here, God, and you don't know about it. You didn't tell me about this. I want to see what this is like. I'm just exploring this. So we turned from God to a corpse, but the corpse only arises for us as an excuse. So when you no longer need to make that excuse, you turn back to God, the corpse, not there anymore. So you don't have to do anything to get rid of the corpse. Understand that? It's only a projection, an excuse that you're projecting. Saying, no, I need to look at this. I need to look at this. This is where the beauty is. This world is where the beauty is, you know. This snapshot, this experience, this photo. I mean, is there anything that gets more tiresome ultimately than photography, photos, really? Go to Flickr, you know. I've just gone through, you know, so many, 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 many photos in my life. Just millions and millions of photos, no question. Just massive amounts. And after a while, you just look at that and say, yeah, but it feels dead. It feels dead. I say, my God, this is horrible. I hate photos. This is terrible. I'm so tired of photos. And even videos. I'm tired of videos, you know, the beauty of videos too. There's nothing like the livingness that you get in Jesus' courtyard. The livingness. You know, there's depth, there's dimension, there's livingness. This is live. This is not on some screen. Even though you could say it's on the screen of your perception, which ultimately means you have to transcend perception altogether, which is another step beyond what we're talking about, so we don't need to address that too much. Now I know the people who love to talk spiritual shop love to talk about, you know, oh yeah, all the way up. Yeah, that's a nice thing. You know, higher than that. There's some higher than that. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But are they actually experiencing? That's the question. Are they just talking shop? A lot of people like to talk shop in various traditions. Not really interested in that too. That's like talking about a corpse. You know, you're looking at a corpse talking shop. What is that? You're looking at a corpse and say, well, you know, yeah, beyond this corpse, there's a lot of stuff, great stuff, and we can even transcend everything and all this blah, 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 and you're still looking at a corpse. That's not going to get it done. So the right thing to do is take the first step. Now, burning away, evaporating the continuity fear to the extent that I've been healed, given me entrance, invitation to Jesus' house and this courtyard, this open courtyard. I says, wow. Now, I didn't know anyone there. I didn't ask anyone's name. Or you're not interacting with people like, what's your name? What do you do? You know, anything like this. Those are just, you know, that's spirit there, your spirit there, that's the spirit. And we're just putting the creativity into this display and then getting it back, reflected back to us. And just saying, wow, we're all just like, wow. There's no socializing, there's really nothing to say. No one needs to say anything. It's you're experiencing what you really want to experience there. We don't say, oh, okay, we had that experience, now let's start talking about the world, blah, 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 blah. No, because this is always responsive. You know, it's just like, wow, look at this beauty. You're just sitting here, you're just... And we try to get this in this world, don't we? Because we feel somehow... We've been orphaned on a desert island somewhere, and this world's like a desert island. We're so utterly bereft of what we really want here. It's just horrible. I don't know, what do you do when you come into this world? It's just horrible. Jesus says it's possible to be here and still see the oneness and just see all this. Everything in the world is just a play of light, of no meaning and no value whatsoever. And let everything arise and let it subside, and don't get attached or value any of it at all. Just allow, you know, just look at it that way. And he says, then you can actually live here in joy and peace and happiness, even while you're here. But there's still quite a lot of limitations by coming into this world. That is for sure. People in this world, we try to desperately manipulate the nervous system to give us all sorts of sensations, manipulate the body, and try to use, you know, vivid concentration or whatever. We desperately try, but this is all effortless, and it's the collectiveness, how the light harmonizes everything. It's just way superior, way, way, way superior. Don't settle for absolute crumbs. You cannot satisfy your hunger on tiny crumbs. You'll always be ravenously hungry if you do it that way. If you try to get it that way in this world, you will always have this ravenous hunger. So it's better to say, yeah, I'm hungry. I got to learn how to fish. I got to remove this continuity fear that I evaporated. That's the way to go here. Jesus said, don't lay your treasures up in this world where, you know, rust, everything rusts, and moths get in and eat everything. Everything's corruptible. Exactly right. This is the backdrop of everything in this world, is the corruptibility of it. He says, lay your treasures up in the world to come, in the higher realm, where you don't experience that. It's not being experienced. You're experiencing manifestation. The light is manifesting for you. And it's like, say, hello, life. Wow, you get this basic introduction to life there. My understood is it's basic introduction, like, you know, just starting out again, reacquainting myself with life. But that's with life, that's a big step. That's a huge step. As Jesus said, life is actually collective, it's the totality of all. It's not the kind of group stuff we do in this world. That's not what he's talking about. It's the totality of all. And I didn't see like a concentrated group effort, because that's trying to, the people, it seemed like they're scattered about, just, you know, some sitting under the shade of this area, the pavilion, some sitting closer to the pool, some here. I didn't know how many people were there. Really wasn't paying attention. I didn't feel there's any sort of coordinated, schematical blueprint to say, okay, we need to see if we can visualize something or anything like that. Because Jesus tells us that that still is trying to give this individual effort, trying to come from the standpoint of separation still, that it leaves God out. Remember, we're co-creators with God, co-creators. So what we need to do is experience both the individual input in the creativity and God giving back to us something that's even better, so to speak. Without losing this, without losing the individuality, it's really amazing how that works. I can't really explain it. It's like I maybe imagine a shimmering golden ring around what is there, and somebody else is imagining this beautiful, soft, dew-like iridescence coming down, and somebody is imagining sort of a billowiness there, and someone is imagining crystalline reflections, and the light like blends this all together in a dance, so for us. and it's just like, holy cow, that's beautiful. Oh my gosh. So you're seeing your contribution, but you're also seeing the dance of the light, the overall the creativity of God too. And then you feel like we're co-creating this along with God, you see. That's what's important. The entirety, the totality of the experiencing is what's important. Your individual contribution, the collective contribution, and the contribution of God all blended together. And it's just like, you're just sitting there and saying, this is absolutely tremendous. Okay, so This starts reminding you of how reality works. So that's the good news. That's the good news. Now, how to get to that courtyard, how to go to that house, get to the courtyard, etc. Oh, we'll find out pretty soon. Because the other dream I had was this, that there's this fence being built. And it's a stockade, actually. And it's going to go up real fast. And the purpose of this is to make us feel like we're fenced in. And can't get anywhere. We can't even look over the fence, right, to a higher realm. In other words, you're being blocked. We're blocking ourselves from the higher realm. Remember, this world's just an excuse for our desire to turn away from God. We're just using it as an excuse. We said, God, we didn't turn away from you. We turned towards this world. God says, what world? What world is that? I don't know any such world. So, no, it's right here, you see. So, well, I didn't create that. That's not our co-creation. Oh, well, that's because it you're not aware, because beyond you, God, this is a realm you're not aware of. That's why we turn towards it, and we'll tell you all about it. We'll show you how to integrate into this world, God. And God says, I don't know this world. Keep in mind, Jesus, when he left, he said, I'm going to my Father's kingdom. This world is not my Father's kingdom. This is not my home. The kingdom of the Prince of Darkness here. This is God. It's not God's realm here. It's not. This is not God's realm here. Although, of course, all the dream is still, yes, it's in everywhereness, of course. But what we're talking about here is that it's an excuse that has arisen for us. Our creativity is like that. We want an excuse, there's the excuse. Oh, see, there's a realm, God. That's why I turned away from you. Right here. I've seen it. And now I'm going to explore that realm. I'll tell you all about it. I'll tell you how great it is. I'll tell you what you're missing out. And then we'll combine the two. You see, that's creativity. We'll combine this realm and your realm, God, into a super realm. No, that doesn't happen. Doesn't happen. So we use this world as an excuse. And when we're continuity fear, unacknowledged continuity fear goes into strengthening the excuse. And now the excuse will be, I can't go anywhere else. I'm imprisoned. What do you mean, God, you want me to, you know, be free? How can I be free? I'm imprisoned. What, are you crazy? That's crazy. He wants me to be free and then he doesn't realize I'm in a prison? You know, hey, hell, hey, get me out of this prison. God doesn't even exist. I don't even see God. What are you talking about? Where? I don't see God anywhere. You see, we imprison ourselves. We see this picture of imprisonment as an excuse. See, unacknowledged continuity fear turns into the excuse. Turns into an excuse. Because that's what we want. We want an excuse why we're stuck here. And lo and behold, we feel stuck here. Now maybe I want an excuse to leave here, which is why I can't get any support for the future here, you see. Can't get it. Because the world is no longer supporting me because I want to leave here. That's gotta be what's going on. But, you know, I don't know exactly. If seeing this fence go up in the world, as I see it, you know, the world is really making a ferocious excuse, saying, leave? We can't leave. What are you talking about, leave? Look at this fence. You can't get out of here. You're stuck here. That's what everyone wants to think. Oh, we're stuck here. We're stuck. Nobody can get out. No, that's just an excuse. Just an excuse. The world is an excuse that we fashioned to hide the fact that we wanted to turn away from God and be separate from God. We said, no, God, we don't want to be separate. We just want to explore this. Oh, this realm, look at this realm. You didn't even tell me about this realm. It's an excuse. It's an excuse. See, what can I do to help? You know, do a detergent video and try to help. It's so crude. It's so crude. You know, it seems like their affirmations are better. Because you have to understand, again, my only problem is the continuity problem. That's the key to salvation, is to recognize it. Your only problem is the continuity problem. You don't have any other problem. That's the key to salvation. You don't have an excuse problem. I don't have an excuse problem. I have a continuity problem. The excuse problem doesn't exist. Only vision of oneness has value. You know? Excuse problem. I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. The world problem doesn't exist. Therefore, there's no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. This is what really works, is the continuity exercise really works. And it's worked to the extent, again, where I was able to meet with Jesus, and Jesus invited me to his home, saying, hey, come on over and visit my house. Would you like to come over to my house and visit? I said, sure. Obviously knowing that I could handle the situation because of all the work I've done, but the continuity problem is the most powerful form of practice that I've seen. I mean, I understand where am I really, or who am I, or those are also very powerful. There are a number of very powerful practices, for sure. Continuity problem practice is one of those, without question. And this, especially right here and now, this day and age, it's very, very effective. So it's not enough to say, hey, I really like cool graphics. That's not enough. Certainly, I'd say familiarity with that takes the edge off a little bit, sure, but the other stuff has to be there too. You know, so the problem is I found that if you get into graphics, you tend to get obsessed with graphics and you forget your continuity practice. And that's never going to work. I put it this way, if you do the continuity practice, that's all you need. You know, it's all you need. If you do that and you get it, you really get it, then the rest of you just, it's a piece of cake. You say, oh yeah, okay, I'm here. This is where I want to be. And this is great. I accept being here. This is what I really want. There's no guilt involved, you see, not guilt involved. You've just turned your back on the excuse you made to turn your back on God, which is fine. It's just an excuse. Now, it's true that this excuse is also formed, is actually being lived by living light, is an expression of living light too. That is absolutely true. And while you're here in this world, you can see everything as an expression of living light. But it's really a super frozen form of living light, and it's really the request that living light appear to be dead to us, as if it were non-responsive. And we really, that's nothing that needs to be maintained. The idea that we're supposed to maintain this universe like this, no way, no way, absolutely not. In fact, God, reality has no need for anything to be maintained at all. Because again, the unmanifest and the manifest, all of that is always available. All of the unmanifest can manifest in any aspect of it, every single instant. There's no limits whatsoever. And all, whatever's manifest, that can all unmanifest, or some of it, or however much, at any instant. Without any loss of the ability to keep doing that forever and forever and forever. So, just having this realm unmanifest like a dream is not the slightest problem at all. Not the slightest problem at all. If we want to ask light to manifest it again, it will. You know, if we want to put ourselves through this again. So, the unmanifest is all, isn't it? Infinite potentiality. Endless infinite potentiality. Every bit of that, all of it, is available this very instant to all. The totality is available to the totality every moment. And just because you're manifesting something doesn't mean that that's detracting from the potential at all. No, you can manifest a universe and that does not deplete the unmanifest at all, because you can manifest the same universe again and again and again infinitely, and that doesn't deplete the unmanifest at all in the slightest bit, because these are just ideas. Ideas aren't depleted by expression, expression, expression. And you can unmanifest universe after universe, universe, and that doesn't deplete the capability to manifest them again. Yeah, not in the slightest bit, not in the slightest bit. squirrels are eating the nuts up there. You can feel a touch of autumn in the air already. What's today? Ah, I forgot my watch. This was like August, what is 11th? Yeah, it's the 11th today. Feels like autumn, because I can sense autumn in the air. It's not far off, is it? Autumn, actually. Wow. Yeah, when the leaves begin to turn in autumn, that's... So... It's important to experience this losslessness of reality. Reality is totally lossless. Completely lossless. The totality can experience the totality every moment without depleting the totality in the slightest bit. You can experience a billion universes this instant, and the next instant you can experience their disappearance, and that doesn't change anything in the slightest bit. You can do it all again the next moment. And on forever and forever. And this does not cause the slightest loss or depletion whatsoever. If someone saw Jesus, the problem is they fear the abyss. They fear the abyss because they think they're going to be dropping their definitions and interpretations. You know, they'd feel that. So they'd say, oh my God, this was one great of distancing. Distancing is a fear of the abyss. The unmanifest is not an abyss. It's everything. Everything forever is the totality, the totalness of the totality. Forever, everywhere, endlessly, everywhere. The totality of the totality, endlessly, everywhere. There is absolutely no abyss. This world seems, you know, to be give us this impression of loss. That's what we want. We want an excuse. This world's an excuse to turn away from God, believe in loss. Okay. We'll just give a little time here to honor the sharing. The best teaching now, I would say, is to simply sit quietly in a courtyard. People just in different places, no particular place, just sitting there, nobody really focusing on somebody else, necessarily, and just sit quietly, sit still. That's probably the best practice now, along with some declarations too. Somebody would, you know, facilitate the declarations without being a center of focus. without being the center of attention or focus. It's something I could do, but not people focusing on me or centering on me, but people maybe looking towards a central area. Just sitting quietly like that and not talking with one another, not interacting. This is rehearsal for the courtyard of Jesus, sitting there looking at a common area there where the light is, the living light is, and is reflecting and harmonizing to all of us the expression that we want to experience. And so we would be sitting very silently there, very calmly, silently, not talking, not to one another. And maybe we might need some declarations to help reinforce, you know, to say it's okay, this is fine, you know, this is, I don't have a world problem, I have a continuity problem. And only the vision of oneness has value. And this is a rehearsal for the vision of oneness, so to speak. And so that would be helpful. I see that as being helpful. So I feel just people coming in, just silent sitting like this. Now, we don't want to force anything. Since there isn't this incredible display, some affirmations might be helpful. A little bit of pattern, you know, just to keep reinforcing so they don't get nervous and afraid, like, well, what am I doing? A little bit of explanation, a little bit of talk, but just this feeling like relaxed, sitting. I don't have to do anything. I don't have to, you know. It's all gonna just be there for me. It's all gonna be there for me. And it's not really a group. You're not trying to form a group, you see. That's also not it. You're not focusing on one person, nor are you trying to form a group. It all just, these are all individuals, but it all just happens. The harmony happens of its own accord, because God is part of it. The living light in God is part of that. So you don't have to form some group where each one is hitting up a certain part, like a choral group or something. I don't see that as necessary. Because we're free to experience whatever we want to experience. Squirrel. It's constantly dropping down shells, bits of shell. It's cracking the nut, you see, you have to get that green part of the walnut off before you get to the nut, and they crack that open and get to the good stuff. Actually, what they usually do is they go bury the nut somewhere. Bury it in your early flower pots, you know, planter pots and garden and all over the place. They'll, you know, thinking they'll get it later. And later they do come and they dig and you see them digging, they getting their nuts, they buried everywhere. That's their rations for the winter. So they're already quite busy. You know, when the squirrels are really putting away provisions, you know, fall is coming. Fall is coming. This is the summer wind right now. The summer wind came blowing in across the sea. And here it is, summer wind. Wow. What a bummer. I love the summer. I like it to be an endless summer, actually. Because everything starts to fade in autumn, just this gradual fade away, you know. Well, that's fine too, but you want it to return right away. See, in this world it doesn't, it goes through cycles. See, it doesn't seem the light is responding to what you want. Because nature has its relentless cycles, whereas looking at Jesus' courtyard, if you want everything to fade away, and then it comes back instantly, you want it to come back, it's all back, you know. So whatever you want, always whatever you want, it's just responsive to, you know, your expressiveness, what you want. It's like, wow. So beautiful. So beautiful. All right. Now, that's the great good news. Bad news is that the stockade's going up. Will go up way faster than you think. Fence can be there. One day the workers are there, next day it's done. And that'll provide a great excuse for those who want to, are too frightened to take the next step. They haven't worked on their continuity fear, unfortunately, which Jesus stood upon the Mount of Olives, warned us all to turn from all our sinful ways. And Simon Peter saw him walking upon the water, and I believe he's walking beside us still today. Jesus saves today, Jesus saves today, Jesus saves today. And thank you, Earl Montgomery, who wrote that song and a lot of other really great songs. Jesus saves today. You can Google it, YouTube search, Jesus Saves Today, George Jones. Very beautiful song. Jesus saves today. That's a fact. That's a fact. He's walking with us today. I just got an invitation from him to visit his home. So he is absolutely here today, working to save us. And we need to be saved in a big hurry, because the world is going to be saying, no, Jesus doesn't save. He can't save you. He cannot save you. Again, the world's an excuse for what we desire. It seems to be forcing all this upon us from outside of us. It's just an excuse we're using to make it seem, oh, I'm not doing this, guy. The world's doing it to me. No, the world's just a reflection of an excuse of what we want to be excused from. We want to say, oh no, the world's imprisoning us, God, instead of, hey God, I've got a very bad continuity fear. Could you help me with that, please? Hey God, I tried to turn away from you. I've been very foolish. I've got a very bad continuity fear. I'm afraid of, I don't know if I could function like you created me. I'm kind of worried about that. Can you give me some gradualism? Can I have some gradualism, please? God says, of course, of course. Jesus knows all about that gradualism. The whole plan of salvation knows all about it. Acknowledge your continuity fear. Acknowledge your continuity fear. Acknowledge your continuity fear. Acknowledge your continuity fear. This is the confession of, this is repentance. Repent, 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 for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent. Say, yeah, God, this was all the world was just an excuse I was making. It was just an excuse. It was all I'm the one who had this desire to turn away. The world didn't force it upon me at all. The world's never forced anything upon me. It's only just been an excuse that I've been using, trying to hide the truth from you, from myself, because I'm afraid, because I have a continuity fear, so that's why I've been holding on to it. Could you help me with that continuity fear, please? Really need help. That's a very severe problem. God says, of course, of course. Jesus, Holy Spirit, the whole plan of salvation, all enlightened beings, is a plan of gradualism. You're welcome into that plan, absolutely. So repent, repent, repent. Confess the continuity problem. Confess the continuity problem. That's what will save you. The unconfessed, unacknowledged continuity problem gets projected out as a world that seems to be doing imprisoning you. It seems to be imprisoning you, holding you back. It seems to be holding you back. So you think the source of your problem is out there in the world attacking you. And then you think you have to defeat the world, overcome the world. You don't have to overcome any world. The world's just an excuse you're making for your own desires. If you repent from your desires, say, God, I want to turn back towards you. You know, but I'm afraid to turn back directly, so can you help me turn bit by bit by bit? And of course, God says yes. And that's the plan of salvation. Now the squirrel's dropping. Walnuts. Boom. That's interesting. So always the world is not doing anything to us, and yet we are using it as an excuse, so we believe it is doing to us, imprisoning us, killing us, keeping us from reality, you know, holding us back, keeping us down, deluding us. Everything the world, we think it's doing the world, is there some world that's doing that to us? No, this world is just a representation of the excuses we want to make, just the excuses we want to make. So what do you do with the excuses? You just stop making them. You don't need the excuse, and then you need to do something with the excuse. You defeat the excuse. No, just stop making the excuse. Trying to defeat it is the same way of saying, no, this excuse was holding me back. That's why I need to defeat it. It was never holding us back. This world has never been holding us back. Never held anyone hostage. Never imprisoned anyone. Not in the slightest bit. So, we don't need to defeat the world. We don't need to do anything to the world. Just turn away from the world. Turn your attention away from it. That's all. Just say, I don't need that excuse anymore. I'm not making excuses anymore. God, I need to work on my continuity problem. I have a severe continuity problem. I need to work on it. Please help me work on it. That's what I need. I want to work on it. Okay? So if you want to work on it, welcome. That's just the attitude. That's the attitude. Hey, God, I got a very severe continuity problem. I want to work on it right now. That's all you need. That's the attitude you need. See what happens. See what happens. So let's see what happens here. Very, very great. That's it.